Well, good day, ladies and gentlemen, from Washington. I am your host of the Robert Christian Show. Hey, I'm Robert. What's your name, and how are you? What is on your agenda? We have a fantastic show on tap for today, and as we go through some of the news items, ladies and gentlemen, I'll tell you what, some of it makes you want to scream. Some of the other news items will make you want to sit back and laugh a little bit, just a little bit. And of course, on today's live show, let us get into it, folks, because we are going to be talking here in the first hour about the Republican facts that you cannot ignore. I mean, I don't know of anybody that can, unless they are completely without brain cells. And in hour two, the Democratic voting record. We're going to be taking a look at that. And we want to know what your opinion is. So if you would like to contact us, ladies and gentlemen, you can do so by calling area 206-736-9688. All right, folks, let us break it down for you. And here is the news. A 33-year-old man was killed today and three others hurt when a construction crane collapsed over and smashed onto a New York City street there in Manhattan about 8:30 a.m. The mayor of New York said that the man who died was sitting in his car. A 45-year-old woman and a 73-year-old man were also hurt, according to what the first responders had said. Also in New York, other news coming out of the city. If the end might be near for a Harlem church known for its hateful public messages condemning gays and President Barack Obama to eternal damnation, and two groups that serve the gay New Yorkers are hoping to get the iconic building from an auction. They want to buy the Ally World Missionary Church as a foreclosure auction. One of them wants to turn this into a housing facility for gay homeless youth. The congregation's pastor, who has vowed not to let that happen, and he says, "We are not going to be pushed like this," according to James David Manning, who literally thumped a leather-bound Bible during an interview at his church this last week, as he said that, "I'm tired of people ramming their ideas down one's throat." Isn't that what he's doing? A fixture in Harlem for more than 30 years, the World Missionary Church has never been shy about expressing its own blunt ideas. The large red billboard out front of the church symbolizing with rotating messages like the one that says, in quotation, "Cursed be thou with cancer, HIV, syphilis, stroke, madness, and the itch, and then hell." Others have gone after Obama, calling him a Taliban Muslim, illegally elected president. Manning, who is black, also rails against sodomites. On one post, Manning report his three-hour daily radio broadcast and a YouTube video with gay slurs. So when the news broke out about the church that it owed $1 million to creditors and was forcing foreclosure, a foreclosure auction is set for February the 24th. However, some quarters will be received with glee, according to the news agencies. Oh, good grief. Folks, don't go anywhere. We have more of the Robert Christian Show upcoming. Stay tuned.
You're watching The Robert Christian Show. We'll be right back. Stay tuned.
Mm-hmm. And once again, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Robert Christian Show from wherever around the world that you are. Hey, it is a pleasure. It is a joy to have you tuning in on today's live show. In the aftermath of a legislative fight over gay rights, Indiana state leader David Long is facing a primary challenge from fellow Republican John Kessler. Social conservatives have been looking for a challenger to keep, or a challenger to Long, ever miss he announced in November, rather, an effort to expand the state's civil rights laws and add protections for gay Hoosiers. The Fort Wayne resident told the Indy Star on Friday that his Long position on a lot of issues, especially on religious freedom and gay rights, don't match up with the values of the voters in his district, stating that I think that freedom of conscience is really a big deal, and I want the power of government telling Christians, or I don't want the power of government to tell Christians to do something that they don't think that it is right. It is not an anti-gay thing. It is not an anti-LGBT thing, that's what he said. It is about what the whole role should be and what role should the government actually play. Because of his faith in God as a devout Catholic, a Texas judge will not be performing marriages for same-sex couples. Bill Mintzer, a Republican justice of the peace in Dallas County, Texas, took to Facebook yesterday, stating that he will only be conducting traditional marriages. In his post, he referred to an opinion by the Texas State Attorney General Ken Paxton, which claims that justice of the peace retain religious freedoms and may claim that the government cannot force them to conduct same-sex wedding ceremonies or other religious objections over their religious objection. Mintzer also claims that because of this opinion, that it is not true for somebody to say that they are required by law to conduct a non-traditional wedding. According to Mintzer, this opinion also came as a result of a question from Texas Lieutenant Governor Dan Patrick. However, within the state of Texas, Harris County, Texas Vince Ryland has a different view addressing the same issue. He conducted this and he concluded that although that the judge or justice of the peace is under no obligation to perform a marriage, once the judge elects to undertake the performance of marriages, the service must be offered to all, including same-sex couples, in a non-discriminatory manner. In other news, Martin Shkreli, the former CEO of Turning Pharmaceuticals, appeared before Congress yesterday as part of the hearing into the drug pricing. Turing is the company that hiked up the price of drug commonly used for those that are suffering from HIV-related toxoplasmosis from $13.50 a pill to $750 per pill. He appeared yesterday on Capitol Hill, and this is what he said.
I just want to make sure you understand, you are welcome to answer questions, and not all of your answers are going to subject you to incrimination. You understand that, don't you?
I intend to follow the advice of my counsel, not yours.
I just want to make sure you're getting the right advice.
I intend to use the advice of my counsel, not yours.
And it goes on.
You gave an interview to a television station in New York where, if I understood you correctly, you couldn't wait to come educate the members of Congress on drug pricing, and this would be a great opportunity to do it. So do you understand you can waive your Fifth Amendment right?
On the advice of counsel, I invoke my Fifth Amendment privilege against self-incrimination and respectfully decline to answer your question.
And so, everybody, you get the gist of it. You get the idea as to the way that that actually went for this man. Shrek, who was also dubbed as the most hated man in America. After he hiked up the price of this drug last September and definitely defended the decision in a series of interviews, faced hostile questioning from Congress members. However, he refused. During that, he refused to speak. But yet he wanted the opportunity. Ladies and gentlemen, he wanted the opportunity to be able to voice his thought, to voice his opinion, to voice his voice, to make his statement. The drug company executives are lining their pockets at the expense of some of the most vulnerable families in our nation, said Elijah Cummings, Democrat of Maryland. As he said, this is not funny, and people are dying, and they're getting sick and sicker and sicker. In a development unrelated to yesterday's hearing, Shrekel was arrested in December by federal agents and charged with illegally taking stock from the same drug company that laid him off back in 2011 and using it to pay off debts of an unrelated business dealings. He was ousted from that company in 2014 and later sued by its board. A new poll by a university shows that Bernie Sanders has virtually erased, get this, has a virtually erased Hillary Clinton's national lead with the Democratic voters in a contest for the heart of the nation. The party. Sanders has swept Democrats off of their feet, and I want to know what you all think. According to this poll, the Democratic-wide, nationwide poll, the former Secretary of State Clinton, Hillary Clinton, has 44%, with Bernie Sanders of Vermont at 42%, and 11% undecided. This compares to 61% to 30% Clinton lead in December 22nd survey by the independent university poll. Bernie Sanders has the highest favorability rating of any candidate of the poll at 44%, net positive approval rating of plus 9%. In contrast, the former Secretary of State Clinton has an approval rating of 39% and an unfavorable rating of 56%. Clinton has a net negative approval rating of minus 17. In the general matchups, Sanders runs stronger than Hillary Clinton. Sanders beats Trump at 49% to 39%, Cruz at 46% to 42%, and ties to Rubio at 43% to 43%. Clinton beats Trump 46% to 41%. Ties with Cruz, and trails Rubio at 48%. Now, I bring that all into perspective, ladies and gentlemen, and I want to know what you all think of it. So far, we have seen some colossal races. So far, we have seen races on for the office of the presidency, both Democratic and Republican. We are beginning to see the caucuses take place in Iowa and in New Hampshire and many other caucuses that are going to be happening around the country. Now, I ask you this question. Is it too early to even consider who you would vote for in the upcoming presidential election? Some folks say, well, no, I'm ready right now, right away to cast my ballot. And if it were possible, some would. As I remember, even Donald Trump said, let's get this over with. Let the voting commence, more or less. Now, I've got a big problem with it. I really do. From my standpoint, I do have a big problem with it. And what it is that we're seeing the clown car debates absolutely end in nothing more than a mudslinging contest. On the Republican side, on the Democratic side, there are two candidates, Hillary and, of course, Bernie Sanders. And both of them have a more stable platform that they are standing on than any other candidate. Now, some folks said, I'm not going to be watching the debate in New Hampshire. I'm not going to be watching this because it was nothing more than Q&A that was ad-libbed, or Q&A that was not really thought of or thought about much. And what happened to Fox News in it? Why wasn't Fox News involved in this? It was Rachel Maddow. You know, I like Rachel. I think that she absolutely did a bang-up, flawless job. Hey, that's my opinion. I've got the right to my opinion. But ladies and gentlemen, quiet as it's kept, here we are seeing our next leader. Either way you look at it, the next leader of the free world involved in a mud-slinging contest. Some folks say, well, Hillary, you know, my issue with her are the top secret emails from a private server. I mean, come on. As Bernie Sanders said, and I so agree. He said, America is tired of hearing, Hillary, about your damn emails. And I agree. Do you agree? I do. I think that Hillary, or that Bernie Sanders, he nailed it. Now, what's interesting is when the facts have been then laid out, that not only did Hillary have a private email server, but also so did Condoleezza Rice. So has many other Republicans. But where are those emails? They want to know about 40-some-odd thousand emails from Hillary Clinton's server. They want to know about these emails. They want to know all about what had happened in these emails and who they were to, why she wrote them, yada yada, all of this stuff. Okay, she's already gone through all this. She already went through a Senate hearing on the matter. Remember that? 13 hours it was, I believe. So she's already gone through that. Okay, but having said that, what about the 40-some-odd thousand emails that suddenly the Republican Party cannot find that came from the Bush White House? Now, should you, as an American voter, should you be concerned with these emails? Or do you side with Bernie and say, you know what, America is tired of hearing about these damn emails, let's move on? Folks, I think we need to move on. I really do. Hey, you know, people they're smarter than what the Republican Party wants people to be. They really are. At least for now, we can claim that. Let's own that. The day and the era that we live in, ladies and gentlemen, it doesn't need to come down to a colossal mud-throwing, mud-slinging contest. What we need in America is a leader that is going to stand up and be the leader of the free world, someone who is not going to be flaunting how many billions of dollars that he has, somebody who is humble, somebody who can be reached, somebody that can be touched, somebody that is in tune with the American populace, somebody that understands what no means and what yes means and what peace means. You know what I had said some time back, and I would encourage you to find this as the truth. America has only had 33 of these. What is it? Now, granted, 33. That's not very much. But with 33, ladies and gentlemen, what is it? If America has had 33 of these in its history, and that's it, it leaves a little bit to be desired, then, doesn't it? What is it? 33 years. Well, ladies and gentlemen, it is 33 years of peacetime, where the United States was not at war, where we were in a peacetime. But since we look at history, it appears that America has become the world's policeman, and it is time to stop that. So, who is it that you would prefer to have in control of the mighty POW button? Would it be somebody who seems to be a lunatic? Really? Somebody with a very short fuse? Would it be someone who is a billionaire and he could care less about everybody else, if that's what it is? All right. Would it be a politician that has been in politics for many, many years, but has stood his ground? He has stood on the terms of the American populace, is more in tune with the American public? Or would you prefer to have the first woman president in American history? Ladies and gentlemen, this coming election, it is already historic. And we have a chance. We right now, it more or less is a 50-50 chance. This is the way I look at it. I think it's going to be like a 50-50 chance that we're going to have the first female president of the United States. But just because of her genitalia, do you think, come on, do you think that she's going to be a weak leader or a weak president? Because, oh, guess what? She doesn't have the sausage and the franks, right? She has something else. And because of that, she's going to be a little bit weaker, right, than perhaps her male counterpart. Shall I say who it is? Ladies and gentlemen, we have the opportunity right now to think about it. And I want to know, what do you think? What is it about our democracy? You know what? And around the world, a lot of countries, and this, hey, I've got to celebrate it, because a lot of countries, they celebrate the American way, our democracy. They like the way that our democracy works, and they, some of these nations, some of these countries are pushing for it this way. But in retrospect, I mean, it's great to have a progressive government, but all of the government, all of the agencies need to be progressive, not regressive, not be like the thumb over everybody's head and all this, and try to sterilize the nation. That's a big problem. Ladies and gentlemen, I said many years ago on television, I said, look, you know, what we need in the States, what we need in a leader, it is a radical leader. That is exactly what we need. We don't need a complete, colossal dumbass. We need somebody that is going to stand up to the plate, and somebody that is going to say, yes, I can do this, and this is how that we can do it and mean it, with a proven track record. You know, and the more and more that I watch Bernie, the more and more I like him. Now, it is not my place to tell you who to vote for or why. What I do a lot of times on Facebook, and it's sort of funny. If you don't follow me on Facebook, you really should. Follow me. Friend me on Facebook or on Twitter. But the funny thing is that when I'm on Facebook and all this, sometimes I will post up there things just to make people talk, just to get them talking. If it's talking about the world of politics or the world of medicine or whatever that it is, and ladies and gentlemen, I do that for a reason. I do it because I want to get a good idea in a unscientific litmus test as to what people are thinking and maybe why. Get some sort of inside idea. Ladies and gentlemen, the democracy that we live in, it is absolutely, in America, it is absolutely fantastic. We have the opportunity, unlike many other countries, to be able to vote for our president. We don't have a prime minister. We don't have a monarchy. But we do have a hierarchy, more or less, in Congress. Hardy har har. And I look, folks, at all of this, and I come to a conclusion, either way that it goes, that America, it doesn't need to be made great again, as if it lost its luster. And I'm telling you, ladies and gentlemen, what has lost its luster, what has lost its freedoms and wheels as it was, is Wall Street. Because a lot of people are not paying attention to Wall Street much anymore. A lot of people aren't. A lot of people have been screwed over by Wall Street. The Wall Street executives, the big bank executives, they've been screwed over by these morons. And I'm with Bernie and with what he said when he was talking about Wall Street and the bailout, stating that to date there has not been one Wall Street banking executive or speculatory committee that has ever gone to jail because of what they did to the U.S. economy. Not so much in other countries. Iceland, that is exactly what happened to them. So, ladies and gentlemen, we need to follow the money. We need to follow the voting records. We need to look at this because it is more than just Wall Street. You look at the Super PAC teams. Let's. And I'm fixing to nail you to the floor. Right? Okay. Let's. If you have a Super PAC team, Quad is a skept, you are going to be more or less in bed with them. If your Super PAC team is from Wall Street, if your Super PAC team are people that have billions of dollars, if they have millions of dollars, if they have huge companies or conglomerates of companies that they run, multi-million dollar, and these are the people that you hang with, these are in your Super PAC team, guess what? It's not just those that are running for president, except for Bernie Sanders, that has a Super PAC team. But it is Congress. It is the Congress and the Senate. Now herein lies a truth. Within the Super PAC teams, get this, your allegiance then is not to the American pop. You listen to what I'm telling you, folks, and I guarantee you, you're going to find out that this is the honest to God truth. Hardy, har, har. The honest to God truth is this. If you have a Super PAC team, you're not going to want to make these people angry. If they are funding your colossal failure in Congress, look at it, 12%, that's what Congress approval rating is. But your allegiance is going to be to the Super PAC teams because they are the ones who are funding you. They are the ones, sort of like a NASCAR driver, who is sponsoring you to remain there. Right? So anything, virtually anything that these companies want you to do, you're going to do it. Guess what? In other words, hey, here is a congressional seat. Here's a Senate seat. It's for sale. Welcome to America. I'm Robert Christian. Life too often has a lot of people down. The news at times seems to be a bore. Ladies and gentlemen, it is because the news, it is not progressive. That is the ticket. If you enjoy progressive talk radio and progressive shows, then you will enjoy the Robert Christian Show, and this will become your home. And we would invite you to tune into the Robert Christian Show every Friday, 3 p.m. Pacific, that is 6 p.m. Eastern, right here from Washington. Ladies and gentlemen, it is far more than what you could ever imagine. But yet we are growing, we are on the move, we are on the cusp of something absolutely fantastic. And we want you to be a part of it. Do it today and don't delay. I'm Robert Christian. We'll see you soon on The Robert Christian Show. And now that we hear, according to the news items, that next year, that they will be working less than 2 days per week and getting, mind you, getting over $200,000 in their base salary just to work for 2 days. And now John Boehner, now that he's officially has been removed, he removed himself as Speaker of the House, and now we think, oh, maybe that was a good thing. Maybe now Congress can get along and work and do what they're supposed to be doing, do what they were elected and voted by the American populace to do. Good old John Boehner, no longer going to be in the news, or is he? Now we have the Speaker of the House, Paul Ryan, and he is completely against medical leave for families. He is against vacation. You know, he is anti-family, except for his own. At least that's what it appears. The Robert Christian Show can be found online at robertchristianshow.com. The only address that you need, it is not your average talk show. We'll be back, ladies and gentlemen, right after this short break. So, ladies and gentlemen, who is it in American politics do you trust? You know, I am very concerned that people would vote for someone who would be the best of the worst, or perhaps the most absolutely ridiculous or radical candidate. You know, look, we can't have a president, Either way you look at it, we cannot have a president, ladies and gentlemen, that focuses more on division than unity. You can't unify America by closing its borders to everyone, attempting to build the Berlin Wall all over again between the U.S. and Mexico. You can't do it. That's not what a free world does. And that surely is not what a potential candidate for the office of the president should even consider. Now, granted, you know, I know that there are going to be people that are going to argue about it. They're going to fuss and fumigate about it. Some folks say, "Hey, I'm all over the Donald Trump. I want Donald. You know, he's a genius businessman. Granted, he is. He's a very good businessman. But in my opinion, he has not said anything, right, that would persuade me personally to vote for him. Now, folks, I like to be progressive. And I think that you do, too. Progressive people don't necessarily think alike, but we do think together. We find an element of truth, and we build a relationship around that truth. We build a network around an idea. That is being progressive. Now, we're certainly not living back in the 1800s or the 1700s. And we do need, absolutely, we need a leader in the White House that is going to lead America forward and not backwards. The next president of the United States is in our midst. And as we consider who that we are going to be voting for, I want you to think about it. And before you do it, ladies and gentlemen, we need to think about it. We need to think very clearly as to whom that is going to be our upcoming president, and come to those conclusions with a clear conscience. Somebody that can be a leader, or is it going to be somebody who has proven themselves to be a complete jerk? Now, it's again, it is not my job. It is not my responsibility to tell you who to vote for. That's ridiculous. But I'm not saying that Bernie or Hillary have the best answers to all of the world's problems. None of them do. Now, if you are going to be looking for a perfect candidate, Republican or Democrat, you're not going to find one. You're simply not going to find one. Herein lies another truth, because a lot of people, they what they're looking for, they're looking for a candidate that is perfect. And then, here comes the reality when later they find, oh, this candidate was not perfect. Okay, what about Congress? The issue with term limits. Now, a lot of people, at least on my Facebook wall, talk about term limits at times. But here is a nugget, and I want you to really think about it. About this nugget of truth on the issue of term limits. And I think that the president, in my opinion, should sign an executive order on it. Hey, if I were president, that's exactly what I would do as a first line of defense to defend Congress and to defend the Constitution of the United States. And that is to immediately issue an executive order on term limits, where the Congress will not be able to serve for 20, 30, 40, 50, 60 years in Congress and continue to sit there and do nothing. What we need in America is fresh ideas, not old blood. We need fresh ideas. We need people that are serving in Congress, people in the House of Representatives, people in the Senate that are average, everyday American people. Now, get this. Where they would not make any more than the average worker in the United States. If they work part-time, they get paid for part-time work. Now you're raising your eyebrows. And you're saying, yes, I agree with that. Okay, that's great. I'm glad that you do. That is what really needs to happen. We want change in Washington. Look, the change in Washington, folks, the people that we want to see, trust me, it is not just in the office of the presidency. Now, granted, the president, Barack Obama, he has done fantastic. He has done quite well, in my opinion, over the last 7 years. He has done better than most. And keeping in mind that Congress from day one has said, well, we don't want to work with him. We have to make sure, as Mitch McConnell said, well, now he's eating crow. He really is. When he made comments by stating, well, we have to just make sure that Barack Obama is a one-term president. Well, guess what? He was elected both times in a legal election. Now, I remember the fiasco in Florida where Jeb Bush, where he was the governor and his brother, George, was running for presidency. And in the second term, they stopped recounting the votes per Jeb Bush. And Jeb, now he is running for president on the GOP side. Folks, look, I laughed at this. I really did. Because he said, well, I'm my own man. I have to run my own campaign. I have to run my own deal. I've got to run this thing and do this, no matter that my brother, no matter that my father was the president too. I've got to run this as my own man. Okay, fine. Good idea, Jeb. But come to find out, what happened was his brother George recently did a commercial spot for his brother Jeb, which is an ad that's going to be running in South Carolina. I don't know, maybe in other parts of the country too, but I know at least in South Carolina, at the very least, and in the media markets, radio and television there. Okay, what happened to Jeb saying, I'm going to stand up and be my own man and try to distance himself from his brother's legacy? Ladies and gentlemen, come on. Come on. Really? That's what I've got to say about it. I think that is the most ridiculous thing that I have perhaps have heard in a long time. Wow. Hey, folks, this is the Robert Christian Show, where your voice, your opinion, they do matter. You can call us at area 206-736-9688. And, of course, visit us on the web at robertchristianshow.com. We will be back, ladies and gentlemen, as we get ready to wind up the first hour of today's live show, and reminding you that, we're going to get into some juice. Yeah, we are. Are you guys going to get ready to get into some of the juice in the second hour of today's show? Oh my, what does the second hour of today's show, what is it going to be about? Oh my goodness. Well, if I told you, we just might have a little bit of problems. We're going to be talking about Bush. Okay. We're going to be talking about Donald Trump. Yep. Okay. We're going to be talking about Chris Christie. Okay. Rubio. Yeah. We're going to be talking about Rubio. And that is just for starters. Folks, I'm Robert Christian with the Robert Christian Show. Welcome to the show, ladies and gentlemen. We'll be back right after this. Well, good day, ladies and gentlemen, from the Robert Christian Show. I'm your host, Robert Christian, and on today's live show, folks, this is going to be a show that you don't want to miss. Whatever that you do today, this Friday, tune into the show because we're going to be talking about political figures. We're going to be talking about Hillary Clinton versus all of the other candidates. We're going to be breaking this down, ladies and gentlemen, just the way that we did with the Republican Party. Are we biased on the Robert Christian Show? The answer is no. But I am going to discuss. We're going to get into this with Hillary Clinton, the former Secretary of State. We're going to be finding out what she did and what she didn't do, and Bernie Sanders, what he did and what he, of course, what he didn't do, and ask this question of everybody today, of any political figure who is sold out to their super PAC teams, their big donors, big corporations that donate to them. Hillary Clinton is one example, not wanting to stand in the fire against Wall Street, to stand against their corrupt behavior on Wall Street because they are a part of her financial backing. And I say, really, Hillary? Really? Today on the Robert Christian Show. The Robert Christian Show, live from Washington, will return right after this. Stay tuned. Don't go away. And folks, hey, we are back. It's good to be back with everyone. So let's look at this. This poll. And some of you are going to be like, hey, okay, let's get into some brass tacks numbers. Okay, well, here's some. Every now and then, not all the time, but every now and then, like at least twice on every show, I prove my point with poll numbers, especially when it comes to this grandiosis deal that we call the world of politics. All right. Here it is, a new poll from Quinnipiac University shows that Bernie Sanders has virtually erased Hillary Clinton's national lead with the Democratic voters. Now, notice with the Democratic voters. In the contest for the heart of the party, Sanders has swept the Democrats off of their feet. And to that, I say, hey, I I would agree. According to the poll, the Democratic national race nationwide, former Secretary of State Hillary Clinton has 44%, with Bernie Sanders of Vermont with 42%, and 11% undecided. This compares to 61-30% Clinton lead in a December the 22nd survey by the same university. Sanders has the highest favorability rating of any candidate in the poll at 44%, and a net positive approval rating of +9. In contrast, Hillary Clinton has an approval rating of 39%, an unfavorable rating of 56%. Clinton has a net negative approval rating of -17. Okay. This is where the rubber meets the road. In the general election matchups, Sanders runs stronger than Hillary Clinton. Sanders beats Trump 49-39. Cruz 46-42 and ties with Rubio. Clinton beats Trump 46-41, ties with Cruz at 45%, and trails Rubio 48-41. Now, folks, those are some of the baseline numbers. Now, if you want to know what that means for the average voter, now, this is not a poll that is based to find out who is more electable, but perhaps more likable. Now, you can be really liked by a lot of people, but not be electable. What makes a candidate electable, that is the reason of the caucuses. If you're going to look at it, let's be honest. That's going to be the reason of the caucuses. Now, some people say, I don't want to go to a caucus. Well, okay, you don't have to go to a caucus. Well, I don't like the candidates that are running. Well, who says that I like them either? I mean, come on. We look at the Democratic side and we see two headliners. We see Bernie Sanders and we see Hillary, both of which that I do support. Both have very good ideas. Bernie has a leg up over Hillary in a lot of ways. One, because he has spent so many years of his life in public service and in Congress. Working with Congress and working with the Senate, both on the Democratic and the Republican side. So he has orchestrated a lot of things over his tenure working for the American populace. And he doesn't have a super PAC team. As he said, and I loved it, as he said, that his average donation is $27. Meanwhile, Hillary Clinton, as well as every other candidate for the President of the United States, has what they call a super PAC team. These are the big money donors. Ladies and gentlemen, really? Really, Hillary? Come on. Really? Hey, that's it. So having said all of that, ladies and gentlemen, in the first hour of today's show, hey, it's been packed, right? November is upcoming, and we have the opportunity, again, in this hemisphere, in this the Western civilization, and the American democracy, we have the opportunity to vote for the candidate of our choice. We have the opportunity to change course in Washington, if we so choose, as far as the president and vice president of the United States is concerned. That alone, that's a tough job. That alone, that's something else that to think that, yeah, let's change presidents every 4 years or perhaps every 8 years. You know, hey, let's get something really motivated and something really going in Washington. Okay, that's all fine. However, on the other side of the coin, the big problem, the big obstacle that President Barack Obama has had since being inaugurated the first time was a Congress that was so illicit, a Congress who refused to work with him. A Congress who refused to work with President Barack Obama at no matter what the expense was. Well, we found out it was at the American voters' expense. You vote for me, we're going to do this. Yeah, right. Vote for me, and I'll do this. Yeah, okay. And here they were. They remember they kept saying, hey, guess what? We are the lame duck Congress. We're the lame duck Congress. That means wada, wada, quack, quack. We're not going to do anything because we don't have to. Hey, except we'll vote for our own pay raise. Yeah. And we're going to do that, and we're not going to vote for the American populace, and we're not going to vote things in for the American. That's beyond us. We don't have to do that, really. And yet, that is exactly what they were voted for. Okay, so we have a Congress that refuses to work with the president. Now, I wonder if the table was turned, and if we had a Republican president, a Republican occupant in chief in the White House, okay, if we had a Republican in there, not a Democrat, but a Republican, would Congress be head over heels to work with him the way that they worked with George W. Bush? Now, I can't blame all of the all of America's ills on Bush. I can't do it. But what I can do is say that Bush, he did not solve the problems. He kicked the can down the road quite a little bit further, right? Just a little bit further. For the ultra wealthy, for the oil tycoons, for those that have and the have mores, those are the people that he really wanted to protect. Those are the people that he allowed to continue to get rich and rich and rich and richer and go on. And his bottom line, and we will soon find out that his bottom line throughout his legacy was that of war and going to war over a lie. Now, if you are progressive, you are going to agree, and you're going to say, yep, 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 I agree. Folks, it's the truth. But if you are a diehard Republican, you're going to say, no, 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 no. You know, he went in there and it, protecting the American people and putting our kids into harm's way and all this. That's all grand. Really? Ladies and gentlemen, America is better than that. You, as a citizen, you are better than that. If you're in the United States, you have what we call a democracy. And we have the right to vote for our president. We have a right to vote for our vice president. We have a right to have our voices heard. And ladies and gentlemen, must it be heard? You bet. Absolutely. Because you know what? Without your voice, without my voice, without the voice of every other American citizen, it's not a democracy. What makes America great, it is not the leader in the White House. It is the people. We the people. That is what makes America great. So if you're going to be voting for a candidate because and solely on the premise of let's make America great again, what happened to it? Did it go somewhere? Did it do something? Is that what it did? Did it go someplace? Did the American dream fly away? Of course it flew away. The American dream is long and forgotten by most Americans. Do you know why? Look at our healthcare system. The American dream of owning your own home. And now you look at Flint, Michigan with the lead in the water. Public waterworks. Public domain. Right? All right. So, yes, something needs to be done about it. Folks, there's a lot of things in America that does need to be fixed. And obviously, this Congress doesn't get it. With the lowest approval rating ever, at 12%, that's what it is. 12%. So, having said that, Folks, we're better than that. I'm Robert Christian. Stay tuned, ladies and gentlemen, for hour two of The Robert Christian Show. Up next.